I feel like I'm walking into hallowed territory here. That was wonderful, Chinelo. And Omoye, nice to see two different takes on feminism. I like to believe I'm a feminist too. Yes, I like God's generosity to man in the form of woman. Either way, thank you all for coming. My name is Joshua. I'm a dentist and a public health specialist. But I aspire to become a public intellectual. You know, someone who can discuss problems other than those in his field of endeavor and still provide cogent solutions. Think about Einstein or Wole Soyinka when I describe that. I'm here because I'm fascinated by complex problems. I've been fascinated with them since birth. In fact, when I was much younger, solving complex mathematical equations was like air for me. If I was bullied outside, or if my parents scolded me, you see me squeezing my face and solving mathematics to calm down. I eventually ended up in the life sciences, but still ended up where complexity is central, which is public health and health research. Now, while doing some research some time ago, I stumbled upon complexity theory. I found out it had such wonderful names such as catastrophe theory, chaos theory, coevolution, self-organizing criticality theory, you know, esoteric names like that. You also know what was interesting? I found out that it explained Nigeria's problems perfectly. And so I want to share it with you. So let me walk you through the relationship between Nigeria and complexity. And the place to start is in the library called the Human Genome. The human genome contains 3 billion base pairs in 23 pairs of chromosomes. To conceptualize its awesomeness, if you stretch what is folded in your body from Pluto to Earth, the 10 billion miles would be covered to and fro by DNA. That is nothing short of a miracle. But do you know that only 1.5% of this codes for humanity? You, me, everybody, just 1.5%. I can see some smart faces there saying, but there are things in DNA that also have important functions, but they don't code for, well, that is true. And it is, they're actually more than the protein coding DNAs. But altogether, all these coding DNAs, both the protein and the non-protein ones, account for just 8%. 8%. That means that more than 90% of what you carry is biologically redundant. That's like driving a car with a bumper that is 60 times longer than the car. Left to you, or me, or simplicity, if you will, wouldn't it be more efficient to just cut the waste? And this leads to my first theory. Thinking that complexity is just simplicity repeated many times and entangled is wrong. Let's bring it home. I'm sure many of us feel that Nigeria would be a better place if we all went our separate ways, you know, and fixed our problems alone. I'm sure you can raise your hands if you believe that. That is analogous to thinking that you should cut the DNA, but that's the wrongest thing that you can do. Scott Peck, an American psychiatrist who died in 2005, said, "Abandon the urge to simplify things, to look for formulas and easy answers, and begin to think multidimensionally to appreciate that life is complex." So why should we treat complexity like royalty? The answer lies in that library called the human genome. Researchers believe that each redundant base pair is actually a repository of information of challenges that we have faced and those that we have not yet faced, you know, a library of the future, so to speak. This library contains information about epidemics, about common cold, about too much sunlight, about living on the mountain, about living in the middle of the sea, about living in Nigeria. And it confers on you, on me, on everybody with this gene, immunity, or at least a fighting chance at survival. Now, if this theory is true, and I think it is, then it means that 90% of what you have has prepared us for a billion challenges that we have not even faced. Some even say we are prepared for the rapture. I hope I've not offended the Christians here. Now, consider this also. There's 98% correlation between the human genome and that of a pig or a mouse. There's 96% correlation between the human genome and that of a chimpanzee. 25% correlation between the human genome and that of some plant. I know what most of us are thinking right now. Me, I know be chimpanzee. Oh. After this show, I go, we lead this guy for us. I go, yana brain. I did not call you a chimpanzee. As someone close to me always says, calm, I'm down. Calm, I'm down. I know I'm not Igbo, so it's important for me to be able to say it very well. Calm, I'm down. Let's imagine that an epidemic surfaces today and wipes out the whole of humanity. Okay, now, it wouldn't wipe out the whole of humanity because we have that immunity. But let's say it wipes out all the pigs, all the chimpanzees, all the leaves, all the plants, everything that man could eat, except man, because man is immune. Won't man die in the end? Won't we eat ourselves for food? So what would be the point of carrying that entire library? What would be the point of the whole of humanity carrying that library? Elaine Van Meel, a medical education researcher, writing on complexity, said, complexity occurs when many connected parts are intertwined. And it is through this interaction that a course of action emerges, a course which may be non-linear and unpredictable. These interactions, where Nigeria's own complexity lies, are those of our tribes and our religions, you know, our culture and our religions, you know, our the distribution of resources and their control. Complexity occurs when many connected parts are intertwined. And it is through the interaction of these parts that a course of action emerges, a course which may be non-linear and unpredictable. These interactions, where Nigeria's own complexity lies, are those of our tribes and our religions, the distribution of resources and their control, our history of slave trade and then our history of colonialism, our longing for morality and our perpetuation in sin, our flirtation with capitalism and our roots in socialism, our propensity for leaders who are well-versed in the other room instead of in the situation room. Oliver Serrat at the Asian Development Bank, in his treatise at Cornell University in 2009, said, in trying to understand complex systems, the approach has been to study the individual parts. But understanding these parts does not necessarily explain how the system functions as a whole. But this is what we have always done in Nigeria. Our attempts at solving our problems have always been linear, you know, solving one problem at a time, hoping everything else will fall in line. Or we try to replicate what we have seen elsewhere and hoping some little modifications will make them fit. But we neglect the main characteristics of complex systems, which is that there's constant movement and response from each and every part, and that the system adapts to guarantee survival. And so, if you fight corruption, of course it will fight you back. And if you want change, you must change yourself. And this leads to my second theory, which is that we, as Nigerians, we have not learned to grasp and convey complex things. You know, to describe them, to understand them, to predict them, to manage them. And this is the key reason why we're a floundering nation. And this is true from the leadership to the followership, from the illiterate to the educated, from the north to the south, from the first to the last generation, from the military to the bloody civilian, from PDP to APC. When you ask a Nigerian to describe a situation in Nigeria, something complex, what do you hear? Nah, I can't even explain itself. Sometimes you can hear the exasperation in their voice. This Nigeria safe. And the one that takes the cake. You cannot understand. Why can't I understand? Do I have a learning disorder? So why is it wrong not to be able to describe an evolving situation? The mere action of trying to explain a situation as concisely as possible fosters understanding. It forces you to first understand the scope of the problem, to tease out the key issues next, and then to begin to present them in order of priority. Sometimes when presenting an issue, and this has happened to me multiply, the solution actually comes to you. Imagine, for example, if our journalist or our Congress could actually describe situations clearly. Maybe they wouldn't be throwing chairs. Take, for example, the genome I presented. If you asked a Nigerian, what would you hear? Oh, my God. As far as most people care, the only important thing about the situation is whether it was God or the devil that did it. Everybody wants to be more Catholic than the Pope, more Muslim than the Prophet, or to release more thunder than Amadioha. Yes. In so doing, we forget the two most important questions for any situation or any set of occurrences, which is why and what can I learn? Nothing else. Why and what can I learn? Now, after a few years of research, I've come to believe that any country that is serious about development has to prioritize three things: education, health, and security. In that order, good roads, stable electricity, a huge economy, all these are secondary. And it's not just about providing financial resources. It's about human resources. In fact, let's push this my untested theory to the limit and say that the best three graduates of every graduate class should be lured into education before health and then security. The impact in education will eventually have spillover effects in policy, in law, in governance, but that's in the long run. So why these sectors? Education, because you need to educate the adults of today to be useful to society and to be useful to themselves in future. And because you need to educate the children to prepare them for this unforeseen future. Let's contrast this with what we call an educational system for now. See, around the world, it is said that those who cannot do teach. But here, it is those who do not know that teach. And I say it with a heavy heart because I'm currently part of the academia. Our graduates are described using words that range from unemployable to misfit. I have personally used the word half-baked, lout, tout, etc. How many of us here have described lecturers in universities using words that range from illiterate to paper professor? Don't many of us here feel it is normal for teachers in schools to be described as beggars or incompetent? Education has truly become the dustbin of society. Why do we need to focus on health after education? Because a society has to be alive to enter this future we are talking about. And yes, you guessed it, health is wealth. So all this economic growth that you want, good roads, stable electricity, and people must be healthy for you to be able to get it or enjoy it. For example, some people argue that the reason why we in Nigeria and Africa are in the position we are, despite our abundant resources, is because collectively our psychosocial health is traumatized. You know, yeah. It's compromised, you know, from post-traumatic stress disorder, from our sufferings and our woes. Now, considering what we read in the newspapers every day, and what we now consider normal in our country, 75 million disappearing, don't they have a point? If a people are comfortable giving tithes and offerings in churches that look like this, and praying in mosques that look like this, but they are okay with hospitals that look like this, shouldn't we collectively be on medication? Why security? Because without it, everything, your health, your education, your economy, your home, and yes, your life, counts for nothing. Let's explore my point a little further. Close your eyes and imagine our military and paramilitary. Imagine how they look, how they dress, how they talk. Now imagine the best three students of your secondary school or university. Imagine them in the military. Can you conceptualize brutalization of civilians standing on the road to collect Egbuje? Now, I know there's a lot of confounding that needs to be teased from this, my argument, but you get my point. And so my third theory is that for a country to have a future, these three sectors must operate at the level of more than even just describing complexity. They must be able to predict and manage it. So, What do I mean by managing and predicting complexity? I'll let this video do the talking.
Exciting scientific findings of the past half century has been the discovery of widespread trophic cascades. A trophic cascade is an ecological process which starts at the top of the food chain and tumbles all the way down to the bottom. And the classic example is what happened in the Yellowstone National Park in the United States when wolves were reintroduced in 1995. Now, we all know that wolves kill various species of animals, but perhaps we're slightly less aware that they give life to many others. Before the wolves turned up, they'd been absent for 70 years, but the numbers of deer, because there was nothing to hunt them, had built up and built up in the Yellowstone Park, and despite efforts by humans to control them, they'd managed to reduce much of the vegetation there to almost nothing. They'd just grazed it away. But as soon as the wolves arrived, even though they were few in number, they started to have the most remarkable effects. First, of course, they killed some of the deer, but that wasn't the major thing. Much more significantly, they radically changed the behavior of the deer. The deer started avoiding certain parts of the park, the places where they could be trapped most easily, particularly the valleys and the gorges. And immediately those places started to regenerate. In some areas, the height of the trees quintupled in just 6 years. Bare valley sides quickly became forests of aspen and willow and cottonwood. And as soon as that happened, the birds started moving. The number of songbirds, of migratory birds, started to increase greatly. The number of beavers started to increase because beavers like to eat the trees. And beavers, like wolves, are ecosystem engineers. They create niches for other species. And the dams they built in the rivers provided habitats for otters and muskrats and ducks and fish and reptiles and amphibians. The wolves killed coyotes. And as a result of that, the number of rabbits and mice began to rise, which meant more hawks, more weasels, more foxes, more badgers. Ravens and bald eagles came down to feed on the carrion that the wolves had left. Bears fed on it too, and their population began to rise as well, partly also because there were more berries growing on the regenerating shrubs. And the bears reinforced the impact of the wolves by killing some of the calves of the deer. Here's where it gets really interesting. The wolves changed the behavior of the rivers. They began to meander less. There was less erosion. The channels narrowed, more pools formed, more riffle sections, all of which were great for wildlife habitats. The rivers changed in response to the wolves. And the reason was that the regenerating forests stabilized the banks so that they collapse less often, so that the rivers became more fixed in their course. Similarly, by driving the deer out of some places and the vegetation recovering on the valley sides, there was a soil erosion because the vegetation stabilized that as well. So the wolves, small in number, transformed not just the ecosystem of the Yellowstone National Park, this huge area of land, but also its physical geography.
Now, it is possible that it's not the wolves that changed the courses of the river. It's possible that they didn't do it alone. there were plenty other things that happened, you know. I don't know how many of us have seen the movie Lemony Snicket, a series of unfortunate events. How, you know, this domino effect, how something, I think there's also this movie, The Butterfly Effect, and how something that you did not know affected this. But the point is, at least they introduced wolves. They tried it out. So DNA showed us that complexity prepares us for unforeseen challenges. But this video showed us something more, something remarkable. It showed us that if one learns how to manage complexity, how to predict it, how to harness it, one can reverse a process that has already occurred. In the process, one can even achieve what wouldn't have been possible if that process did not occur in the first place. Imagine our beloved but frustrating Nigeria. Is it possible we can build out of this disappointment we have endured? Is it possible our current problems are the raw materials for solutions that the entire world is seeking? Could Nigeria's complex problems be that simple? Thanks for listening.